So it's a pleasure to be here and to speak with you about my research on COVID-19. Again, I'm going to talk about the application of big data analytics on COVID-19 using different kind of molecular data. And I'm going to show you like an overview of different studies that my group is carrying on. So let's start. I have no conflict of interest. Here are a few statistics about COVID-19, as we all are painfully aware, like COVID-19 impacted our life in a way that no one could have imagined. Here are the numbers. We have more than 200 million cases and more than 4 million deaths. And fortunately, right now, more than 5 billion vaccine doses were administered worldwide. Outcomes, the medical outcomes related to the COVID-19 are due to a series of interaction between genetic variation and environmental factors. So Dr. COVID-19, Renato? Yes.
Yeah, your slides are not moving.
Oh?
Yes, yeah. And can you make it full screen?
Yeah, like, let me try again.
Ah, yeah. So can you make it full screen?
Yes. So now you should see my slide with the COVID-19 statistics.
Right. And now we can see the virus there.
Sorry?
Now we can see the COVID-19 virus there, yeah.
Okay, great.
All right.
So yes, as I was saying, like COVID-19 is a multifactorial phenotype. So we have many complex biological and non-biological factors that are interacting with each other. So if we understand better how all these complex networks work, we can have better treatments, better preventive strategies. So it's important that we use all the data that we have to improve healthcare for people affected by COVID-19. So now you should have seen my slide moving, right? Or you are still on the COVID-19 slide? Sorry, can you confirm that?
Yeah, can you make it full screen so that you can actually?
I am full screen and I'm moving my slides. So on my computer, it's moving.
Okay, it is not. Now it actually it is moving.
Yeah, but now I'm not in full screen. I don't know why it's not getting my full screen. Let's try again, or maybe I'll try to do something. Stop sharing, and I'll share again. Share this. So now you should see my full screen. Let's try again. So right now you are seeing like...
Now it's full screen, right.
Okay, great. So as I was saying, we need to use all the data that we have to understand better this disease. So genetic information can be used to both investigate the biology and the epidemiology of COVID-19. So in particular, genetic association data, and again, more in particular, genome-wide association data can be used both to translate statistical association in information about biological pathways and molecular function. We can use different kind of approach based on pathway analysis, gene ontology enrichment, and tissue and cell type specific annotation based on transcriptomic profiles. And all these analyses can be very important to understand better the relevant pathways that lead to the disease. And from there, we can perhaps develop better drugs. But also we can use genetic association as an anchor for causal inference. Because as we know, genetic variation, germline, genetic variation doesn't change during our life. So we can leverage the genetic association as an anchor to investigate the causal relationship, the cause-effect relationship of the association that we are aware. As everyone knows, correlation is not causation. So also an association is not a causation. So with genetic information, we can do a causal inference analysis using approaches like Mendelian randomization or latent causal variable analysis to understand better the epidemiology of the disease, which are the risk factors, which are the causes of certain medical outcome of COVID-19 or which are the consequences of COVID-19. So both these distinguishing these two different things is really important. So an amazing effort that led by several groups is the COVID-19 host genetic initiative. So different investigators around the world got together and shared data and generated a huge amount of genetic data about the susceptibility to COVID-19 using different kind of definition, like hospitalized COVID-19, severe respiratory symptoms. And using this data, we can have better information about both the biology and the epidemiology. My group was involved in the in-silico analysis of this study published in Nature, and new data are being collected. So the one on the bottom here are the numbers that now the COVID-19 AGI generated across 60 different studies from 25 different countries. It's an amazing effort. And these data are available. So other groups that are not involved in this consortium can access this data and try to do additional analysis. So because we need all the statistical power to investigate this data. So today I'm going to show you briefly four different approaches that my group applied to COVID-19 AGI data to investigate both the biology and the epidemiology for the disease. In particular, I'm going to show you two different approaches. One based on hypothesis-based design. So we have an hypothesis, we use genetic data to investigate this hypothesis. And the other is an hypothesis-generating design. So we use big data analytics to generate new hypotheses. So these are the two studies that I'm going to show about the disease biology. So the first one is about ACE2, which is the key adhesion molecule for the transmission of the virus. And this study was led by Gita Patag, an amazing postdoc in my group. So we know that ACE2 protein is really important for the infection. But when we look to genetic association, we see that variation within ACE2 gene has only a small effect on COVID-19 outcomes, because this disease is highly polygenic. So there is not a single gene, but there are many genes that affect the susceptibility to this disorder. So what we did is to use multi-omics information to investigate the gene network related to ACE2. It's not moving. Why it's not moving? Why it's not moving? Okay, let's try again. I'm not sure why it's not going in presentation mode.
You have a connection issue there?
I don't think it seems like a computer issue, but I don't understand why. No.
Yeah, it came.
Okay, let's do. I'm so sorry, I don't know why today is. Okay, so maybe you can see here in the small slide. Let me try to. Yeah, now it's completely freeze.
Yeah, it is fine.
Okay, we are here. Let's see if we can project the slide. Okay. I'm so sorry.
You are in the left panel. So can you click on the right panel there?
Yeah, like I can speak of. So like we used this multi-omics approach to integrate a network of H2 gene, and in particular, we use transcriptome profiles of these genes to investigate which are the relevant issues. So we created this huge network of different genes and understand which one are upregulated and downregulated. And then from there, we use information. Now I'm trying to go to the next slide, but it's not moving.
Now it came.
Yes.
Yeah.
I don't know why. And then it gets freeze. I'm trying to. Okay. Let's try again.
Yeah. Let's try.
I'm so sorry. Let's try again. So we were here. Let's see. Okay. Maybe we can do it this time.
Yeah.
Okay. Yes. So I was saying we have this huge network of different genes and uses transcriptomic tissue-specific transcriptomic profile. We were able to understand better which are the genes that are upregulated and downregulated, and which are the relevant tissues for the ACE2. Gene network. The effect of different drugs on transcriptomic profiles of ACE2 gene identified two genes, the spironolactone and the dexamethasone, as potential drugs that they can affect ACE2 gene network, leading to possible treatments for COVID-19. And actually, from this computational analysis, we were able to find a concordance with ongoing COVID-19 trials for these drugs. So this means that computational approach, increasing the power of the datasets that we have available, we can identify additional drugs that could be useful for COVID-19 treatments. So, there were another couple of slides, but unfortunately it seems that the computer doesn't want me to show you. So let's move to a different study. So this is another study that Gita led and was a collaboration with different investigators from UCLA, Vanderbilt, and USC. And we use, again, COVID-19 AGI datasets and integrated these datasets with, again, tissue-specific transcriptomic profile and also proteomic profile, and then conducted a transcriptome-wide association study. So in this case, we are using an hypothesis-generating approach. So instead of focusing on a specific hypothesis, like the study before on ACE2, we are investigating the entire genome. And from there, we identified several genes and understood their effect on different tissues and regarding both gene expression and protein expression. And then from there, we investigated possible pathways and also analyzed the phenome-wide impact of these genes. So here you have like all the genes that we identified here on the left. And then we have the association with COVID-19 hospitalization in different tissues and seeing like what is the effect is an upregulation of the gene or is a downregulation of the gene. So using this information, we were able to then conduct a phenome-wide association analysis, leveraging the gene expression profile and the protein expression profile. And it, for example, we identified many associations of these genes with traits related to the circulatory system and in particular to the genes that were in the ABO gene cluster. And so, as we know, circulatory system play a key role in COVID-19 susceptibility. But then we also found other genes that were associated with possible consequences of COVID-19, like migraine, throat pain, and also high tissue. So this means, again, that we can use genetic information again to move beyond the statistical association and try to find better understanding of both the molecular and the phenotypic consequences of the disease. In the second part of my talk, I'm going to talk about how we can use genetic association statistics to investigate the disease epidemiology. So in the first one, I'm going to show you an hypothesis generic design where we use COVID-19 genetic data to investigate the causal network linked to the disease. In the second one, we are going to investigate a specific hypothesis about the possible relationship between obesity and COVID-19 and the potential role of socioeconomic status as a mediator of this association. So this first study was conducted by Frank Wendt, another postdoc in my group. And as we all know, epidemiological studies based on observational analysis can be biased by possible confounder or unassessed variables. For example, if you want to track COVID-19 infection through the usage of an app, this could be a good approach, but then you have a possible confounder that people of a younger age are more likely to use the app usage. So you investigating this kind of a data set, you may have a bias due to the age. Another sampling issue that you may have is, for example, like investigating COVID-19 severity and then selecting people that are getting tested. And then, like, maybe in the sample that you are investigating, there is a bias because most of the people that are getting tested are healthcare workers that are mandated to test. And so you are biasing your analysis because you are investigating a subpopulation, and then you can have another possible risk factor, which is smoking, which may be in healthcare workers in a different prevalence than in the general population. And then another possible scenarios is when you are investigating a possible risk factor, which is the use of ACE inhibitors, and then you are selecting people that are hospitalized for COVID-19, and your outcome of interest is to understand which is the risk of death. And then you are making an inference about the effect of ACE2 on death, but then you're also maybe not analyzing the possible bias induced by the fact that people that use ACE inhibitors are usually people elderly that have like a high susceptibility to have a negative outcome in response to a severe disorder like COVID-19. So all these biases means that we need to have a larger approach to investigating possible causal mechanism related to COVID-19, where we have to investigate multiple variables at the same time. Unfortunately, like doing this thing using observational data can be really expensive and time consuming. So we can use genetic information to make causal inference about COVID-19. So in this study, which is currently on preprint on MedArchive, we use different approaches. We conducted an initial screening using a genetic correlation analysis between COVID-19 and different traits, for example, related to anthropometric traits, to different disorder, to medication use. And then from there, we conducted a latent causal variable analysis to distinguish this genetic correlation. As I said, correlation is not causation. So the genetic correlation between two traits doesn't mean that there is a causal relationship. But then we applied a causal inference analysis and try to create a network of causal relationship linking severe respiratory COVID-19 and hospitalized COVID-19 patients with different factors. So this large network can give us a better understanding of possible causal effect that increase the risk or have a protective effect of COVID-19. And we also in this study did another phenome-wide analysis with respect to blood metabolites and found possible association with different genes associated with COVID-19, and also investigated how these associations are different across different populations. Because unfortunately, as we all know, that there is a bias of in genetic research, because we have much more data about the population of European descent with respect to other populations. So this final study is about, which was led by Brenda Cabrera Mendoza, again, another great postdoc in my group, was to investigate a specific hypothesis. We know that obesity is a risk factor for COVID-19, but because like obesity can affect the ACE2 receptor expression, which again is the key entrance point for the virus, obesity can also increase chronic inflammation and can also reduce immune function. So having all these pathways affected by obesity can increase the risk of negative health outcome related to COVID-19. So we wanted to know if the effect of COVID-19, of obesity on COVID-19 was direct or was mediated by another factor, and in particular by socioeconomic status, because we all know that socioeconomic status is both associated with COVID-19 risk and also with obesity. So we conducted a Mendelian randomization analysis, which is a causal inference approach based on genetic data, and investigated the causal effect of different anthropometric traits related to obesity, BMI, waist circumference, hip circumference, and also like adiposity distribution. So waist circumference adjusted for BMI, because as we all know, for example, that abdominal fat is a increased risk factor for many cardiovascular disease. So we did this Mendelian randomization and we found that BMI had the largest effect on COVID-19 risk, and in particular with severe respiratory COVID-19 and hospitalized COVID-19, and a reduced risk with COVID-19 infection. And instead, like for the one, for the anthropometric traits that were related to body shape, so fat distribution, we didn't find a very strong causal effect. On the other side, we confirmed that socioeconomic status assessed as household income had a protective effect on COVID-19 hospitalization and severe symptom, but not a significant effect for infection. So we conducted a multivariable Mendelian randomization that can be compared to a factorial randomized trial where you investigate the effect of multiple risk factors. And here we can see the univariable Mendelian randomization where we do a test between the anthropometric trait and the COVID-19 outcomes without assuming any other variables. And again, we have a positive effect for BMI, hip circumference, and waist circumference of both severe respiratory COVID-19 and hospitalized COVID-19, and a protective effect for household income. But then when we do a multivariable Mendelian randomization, when we combine the effect of these anthropometric traits with household income, both BMI, hip circumference, and waist circumference didn't have a significant effect anymore on COVID-19 outcome. So this means that the effect of these obesity-related traits is partially mediated by socioeconomic status. This means that, yes, it's important to assess obesity as a risk factor for COVID-19 negative outcomes, but this should be done in the context of socioeconomic status, because this is an important variable that is affecting this association. So again, take home messages from this presentation is that yes, we need large genome-wide association study and we need these data sets to grow more, because in this way we'll have more statistical power, because this can be very informative to conduct analysis to understand the molecular basis and the epidemiological dynamics of COVID-19. These datasets can both be used to conduct investigation testing specific hypotheses, but also use big data analytics to generate new hypotheses about the disease. Of course, genetic data cannot be only the only datasets that we investigate, but this data can need to be put in context of observational study, clinical trials, so we can bring all the data together and see which information is converging to a specific mechanism or to a specific cause-effect association. So finally, I have to thank all the people in my group. As I mentioned, most of the study were conducted by postdocs that work with me. Of course, I have to thank